Hello everyone, myself Dr. Deepika Sharma from Department of Botany, Zakir Hussain Delhi College. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce our speaker, Dr. Swarnendu Roy. Dr. Swarnendu Roy is Assistant Professor at University of North Bengal, Siliguri, India. He has more than 11 years of teaching experience. Dr. Roy has been a recipient of University Gold Medal for securing first position at BSc. And University Silver Medal for securing second position at MSc level. He was also a recipient of Postgraduate Merit Scholarship for University Rank Holders, which was awarded by the Ministry of HRD and UGC, Government of India, and CSIR Junior Research Fellowship awarded by CSIR UGC during his PhD. Dr. Roy has published more than 20 research articles in reputed journals and several book chapters in edited volumes. Presently, he is actively engaged in research on the mechanism of salinity and drought stress in cereals and legumes, stress management by functionalized nanoparticles, and bioinformatics studies on stress-related transcription factors. He is presently supervising 4 research scholars, including 3 UGC JRFs, and has guided 14 MSc students for dissertation. Dr. Roy is a life member of prestigious societies like the Indian Science Congress Association and the Association of Food Scientists and Technologists India. Now I invite Dr. Swarnendu Roy to deliver his lecture. I'm sure our participants will enjoy and benefit greatly from his talk. Thank you.
Welcome everyone to this video lecture. I am Dr. Swarnendu Roy, Assistant Professor, Department of Botany, University of North Bengal. I will be presenting a video lecture on types and methods of data collection. As all of us are aware that data collection is essential for business, organizations, commercial sector, and even in personal use. In the digital age, data is one of the most valuable resources at our disposal. The right data used properly can propel you forward by helping you make the right decision in areas such as choosing a market segment, finding the ideal marketing mix, financial decisions, and many more. When used incorrectly, it can seem like the choices being made by you or your team are always falling short. So therefore, how can you make sure you have the right information to make important decisions? So it can be made sure by adopting sound data collection methods and analysis. So that will be discussed in this video lecture, and I will be mainly try to focus upon the types of data and mostly upon the methods of the data collection. So let us begin. Let us first discuss what a data is actually. Data is a word derived from Latin etymology, which is used to describe a collection of natural phenomenal descriptors, including the results of experience, observation, or experiment, a set of premises or information within a computer system. This may consist of numbers, words, or images, particularly as measurements or observations of a set of variables. Experimental data are the data generated within the context of a scientific investigation. In simple terms, data means information. The information collected from sensors or surveys or from other sources is called raw data. The adjective raw attached to data indicates that the information collected cannot be used directly. It has to be converted into more suitable form before it begins to make sense to be utilized gainfully. So, raw data is like raw rice. Raw rice has to be cooked properly and tastefully before it is eaten and digested. Similarly, raw data has to be converted into proper form, such as tabulation, frequency distribution form, etc., before any inference is drawn from it. A dataset of some basic measurement or measurements of individual items are called elementary units, which may refer to people, households, farms, cities, TV sets, etc. The same piece or pieces of information is recorded for each one. A piece of information recorded for every item is called a variable. So, the dataset can be classified majorly in 3 ways. So these are actually, that means the data set can be classified on the basis of the number of variables. So this can be univariate, bivariate, or multivariate. It can be classified on the basis of the kind of information that is contained. So which can be either in numbers or categories, or also it can be determined by the time series, or it can also comprise cross-sectional data. The complexity of the data set is decided based upon the numbers of variables or pieces of information recorded for each item, which guides us to select the proper tool for analysis. That is, one has to decide whether the number of variables present is univariate, bivariate, or multivariate. So let us first talk about the univariate dataset. So the univariate or one variable datasets have a single piece of information recorded for each item. The basic properties of this single piece of information can be summarized using the statistical methods available. So let us talk about few examples. So number one, the statistical analysis of data collected regarding the income level through a marketing survey, which reveals the distribution of income, specific income level, and variation in the income level and the number of people within any given range of income, is such example of a univariate data set. Similarly, statistical analysis of the quality control regarding production could be used to keep check on quality and to verify whether or not the production is carried over in a proper direction. So this is another example. So let us take another example. The statistical analysis regarding the bond ratings of the firms in an investment portfolio, which indicates the risk of the portfolio, is also an example of an univariate data set. So what is a bivariate data set? So the bivariate or two variable data sets have exactly two pieces of information recorded for every item. Application of a statistical analysis would reveal the relationship between these two variables under study. Apart from this, the study would help us to predict the value of one variable when the value of the other variable is given. So let us take few examples. Example number one, consider a table that comprises the cost of production per unit of different companies and the number of units produced of a specific commodity for the past 6 months. One of the bivariate statistical analysis tools, namely correlation analysis, can be applied in order to study the degree of relationship between the cost and the number of units produced. Moreover, using the regression analysis tool, we can estimate the cost of producing an item if we know the number of units to be produced and vice versa. Here, in this analysis, the cost of production is taken to be the first variable and the units produced are considered to be the second variable. Let us take another example. Consider the table comprising of the date and the corresponding market share price of a firm recorded every day for the past 1 year. The relationship between the price and time would imply the recent trends in the value of your investment. The estimation analysis helps us to predict the future price of the market share. So in this case, the date and the share price are the two variables which constitutes the bivariate dataset. So let us now talk about the multivariate dataset. So the multivariate dataset, it has at least three variables, and multivariate datasets have a minimum of three pieces of information recorded for every item. Statistical analysis can be applied to study the interrelationship between all these variables. Moreover, an estimation analysis can also be done by combining all the variables put together. So let us take a few examples. So example number one, consider a table consisting of the information regarding gender, total years of experience, designation, performance level, and salary record for each employee. Multivariate analysis could help us to decide whether women are discriminated in terms of the salary paid or not. So all these criteria, the experience, designation, performance level, and salary, so all these are the different variables which constitute the multivariate data set. So let us take another example. Consider a table that comprises of the growth rate, strategy, adopted, type of equipment used, investment level, and management style for each number of new firms. The statistical analysis would give a clear picture that out of all the information provided, which combinations have been the most successful. So in this case, the growth rate, strategy adopted, type of equipment, investment level, and the management style constitutes the multivariate data set. So there are other types of data sets that are numerical and categorical data sets. So in the numerical data sets, the data are expressed in the numbers rather than the natural language. So the numerical data is sometimes also called the quantitative data. For example, number of pages present in a book, weight and height of a person, etc. Whereas the categorical data sets represent features or characteristics of a person or an object. The categorical data set consists of a categorical variable, which are also called as the qualitative variable, that can take exactly two values. For example, a person's gender. For a person's gender, it can be either male or female, or marital status, which can be married or unmarried. So there are other types of data sets like the time series data set and the cross-sectional data set. So the time series data set focuses on observations of a single individual at different times, usually at uniform intervals. It is the data of the same variable over a period of time, such as months, quarters, years, etc. For example, profit of an organization over a period of 5 years' time. So in this case, the profit is the variable that changes every year. So usually, time series data is useful in business applications. Time measurement can be months, quarters, or years, but it can also be any time interval. Generally, the time has to be have uniform intervals. Whereas, the cross-sectional data sets are represented by several variables at the same point in time. So the data set with maximum temperature, humidity, wind speed of few cities on a single day is an example of a cross-sectional data. Another example would be the sales revenue, sales volume, number of customers, and expenses of an organization in the past month. Expanding the data from several months will convert the cross-sectional data to time series data. So therefore, the main differences between the time series and cross-sectional data set would be that the time series data focuses on the same variable over a period of time, whereas the cross-sectional data focuses on several variables at the same point in time. However, broadly speaking, in statistics or biostatistics, data can be majorly divided into two types. One would be primary data, and the next one would be secondary data. So, what do you understand by primary data? A primary data is represented by a set of data collected by an individual or organization directly from the field of inquiry for a specific purpose. These data are original in nature and collected by trained investigators. Most often, the data are considered primary and are published in some form by the collecting agent. So in this case, they may be government agency, civil bodies, any individual, and so on. It is often the case that published primary data contain information on how the data were collected, along with suggested interpretations and usage of the data. The collection of primary data is not so simple. It is a tedious work, a time-consuming process, and even costly. So how the primary data differs from the secondary data? So the secondary data is characterized by the data collected by some other person or organization for their own use, but the investigator also gets it for his own use. Secondary data is essentially republished information. So it is basically a republished information. So that is, if the same set of data is called primary when it is in the hands of individuals or organization who collected directly from the field, and the same will be called as secondary if it is in the hands of another person who is going to refer to the same for some other study. For example, the consumer price index is republished in Economic Times and mostly in major daily newspapers. So these are usually characterized by the lack of information on how the data were collected and dearth of suggested uses and interpretation. The important sources of the secondary data are publications of the state and central governments, international bodies like UNESCO and United Nations, foreign governments, trade associations, cooperative societies, labor and trade union reports, research papers published by the research scholars, etc. So let us try to understand that what are the basic differences between a primary data and a secondary data. So let us sum up the basic differences. So we already know that the primary data are collected by researcher or the organization directly from the field of study. However, the secondary data are collected by somebody and provided for comparison purpose. Primary data gives the complete information about each data set. However, secondary data does not always give the complete information about each data. primary data is more reliable, whereas the secondary data is not so much reliable. So collection of the primary data needs more time than the collection of the secondary data. The limitation of the primary data also can be evaluated based on the methods and the mode of the collection. However, this facility is not possible in case of the secondary data. Therefore, it could be summarized that as because the primary data are collected by the person who concerns, so this type of data is more suitable for study in comparison to that of the secondary data. So let us now take our discussion to more details to understand the different types of primary data. So basically, the primary data can be generally classified into the following types of data. So it can be classified into nominal data, ordinal data, ranked data, discrete data, and continuous data. So one by one, we will try to discuss the different types of primary data in detail. So let us first discuss about the nominal data. So in the study of biostatistics, we meet many different types of numerical data. So the different types have varying degrees of structure in the relationship among possible values. One of the simplest type of data is the nominal data, in which the value fall into unordered categories or classes. Nominal data is also known as the nominal scale, and it is a type of data that is used to label variables without providing any quantitative value. So in a certain study, for instance, male might be assigned the value of 1 and females the value of 0. So the numbers are used mainly for the sake of convenience. Numerical value allows us to use computers to perform complex analysis of the data. Nominal data that take on one of two distinct values, such as male and female, are said to be dichotomous or binary, depending on whether the Greek or Latin root for the two is preferred. However, not all nominal data need to be dichotomous. Often there are three or more possible categories into which the observations can fall. For example, persons may be grouped according to their blood type, such that 1 represents type O, 2 represents type A, 3 represents type B, and 4 represents type AB. So basically, the nominal data represents the qualitative data rather than the quantitative form. So what is ordinal data? So when the order among the categories becomes important, the observations are referred to as ordinal data. So when numbers are purposefully assigned to the data that have a sense of rank or order, but the magnitude of the difference between these numbers is not known or cannot be measured, the data refers to ordinal data. So unlike the nominal data, the assigned numbers are not arbitrary. This type of data scales does not allow for the calculation of an average or mean, since the magnitude of difference between each assigned number is not the same. For example, injuries may be classified according to their level of severity, so that 1 represents a fatal injury, 2 is severe, 3 is moderate, and 4 is minor. Here, a natural order exists among the groupings. A smaller number, therefore, in this case, it represents a more serious injury. So now let us discuss about the rank data. So in some situations, we have a group of observations that are first arranged from highest to lowest according to the magnitude, and then assign numbers that correspond to each observation's place in the sequence. This type of data is known as your rank data. In statistics, ranking refers to the data transformation in which numerical or ordinal values are replaced by their rank when the data are sorted. As an example, consider all possible causes of death in India. We could make a list of all the possible causes along with the number of lives that each one claimed in. If the causes are ordered from the one that resulted in the greatest number of deaths to the one that caused the smallest number of deaths, and then assign consecutive integers, the data are said to have been ranked. So let us come down to the understanding of the quantitative data. So there are two types of quantitative data. So one is your discrete data and continuous data. So discrete data is basically a type of primary data which represents the actual measurable quantities rather than mere labels. So for discrete data, both ordering and magnitude are important. In this case, the numbers represent actual measurable quantities. In addition, discrete data are restricted to taking on only specified values, often integers or counts that differ by fixed amounts. So in this case, no intermediate values are possible. So example of discrete data would be the number of motor vehicle accidents in a certain city in a particular month, the number of times a woman has given birth, the number of new cases of tuberculosis reported in India during a one-year period, the number of beds available in a particular hospital, etc. So you can note that for the discrete data, a natural order exists among the possible values. So if we are interested in the number of times a woman has given birth, for instance, a large number indicates that a woman has had more children, whereas a smaller number indicates that a woman has few children, so maybe one. So furthermore, the difference between 1 and 2 births is the same as the difference between 4 and 5 births. So you can also see that the number of births is restricted to the non-negative integers, and a woman cannot give birth 3.4 times because it is meaningful to measure the distance between the possible data. So the discrete data are most of the time represented by values which has equal difference. So what is a continuous data? So the data that represents measurable quantities but are not restricted to taking on certain specified values such as integers are known as continuous data. So on the contrary to discrete data, in this case, the difference between any two possible data values can be arbitrarily small. Examples of a continuous data would be time, the serum cholesterol level of a patient, the concentration of a pollutant, and temperature. So you can see that in all the instances, fractional values are possible. Since we are able to measure the distance between the two observations in a meaningful way, arithmetic operations can be applied. The only limiting factor for a continuous observation is the degree of accuracy with which it can be measured. We often see time rounded off to a nearest second and weight to the nearest pound or gram. The more accurate our measuring instrument, however, the greater the amount of detail that can be achieved in our recorded data. So based on our understanding of the different types of the primary data, so it can be concluded that a certain type of data may be useful in some circumstances and not in the other. So let us take an example to understand the same. So in a study of the effects of maternal smoking on newborns, for example, we might first record the birth weights of a large number of infants and then categorize the infants into three groups: those who weigh less than 1500 grams, those who weigh between 1500 and 2500 grams, and those who weigh more than 2500 grams. Although we have the actual measures of birth weight, we are not concerned with whether a particular child weighs 1560 grams or 1580 grams. We are only interested in the number of infants who fall into each category. From our prior experience, we may not expect substantial difference among children within the very low birth weight, low and normal birth weight groupings. Furthermore, ordinal data are often easier to handle than continuous data and thus simplify the analysis in this case. So there is a consequent loss of detail in the information about the infants if we use the ordinal data. However, in general, the degree of precision required in a given set of data depends on the questions that are to be answered. Therefore, all the types of data sets have significant usage in some or the other circumstances. So now let us talk about the data collection. So different type of data collection methods. So see, data collection is actually the process of gathering and categorizing relevant information that can be then be used to make decisions about specific situations. In every aspect of our lives, we go through the process of data collection. For example, if you want to move to a new city, you would like to collect as much data as you can. Like you would like to collect the information about the climate of the city, the transportation of the city, etc. Also, when assessing a new job offer, you want to collect the data about the company's growth, salary scale, etc. So therefore, statistical data are collected through statistical inquiries. These inquiries should be properly planned, and then the required data must be collected. After the collection of the data, these data need to be classified, tabulated, analyzed, interpreted, and presented in an easily understandable form. So therefore, careful planning is advocated for the success of data collection. Planning includes the clarity of its object and scope, the selection of the method of inquiry, and the degree of accuracy in this case. So there are certain prerequisites for the collection of data. So for the collection of data, firstly, the object and scope of the inquiry should be predetermined carefully. This is because if there is no clear vision regarding the data needed, unimportant data may be collected and important data may be omitted. This may lead to waste of time and waste of money. For example, a cosmetic manufacturer wishes to know more details about the retail sales of their product. They may inquire about the number of ladies, adults, and children in the family of the consumer, the number of items consumed, the brand of cosmetics they use, the type of quality they like, etc. With this in view, the data collection schedule is prepared. Secondly, the methods of inquiry must be carefully selected. There are different methods of inquiry, each suited for specific purpose, which we will be discussing in the coming slides. So, for example, if the entire pollution has to be studied, a census inquiry is undertaken. If that will be too costly and too time consuming, a sample study is made. Particularly, if the sample is random and sufficiently large, at least 20 to 30% of the size of the population has to be selected for the collection of data. So in that case, this will provide a very good result. After deciding the size of the sample, the next stage is how the data is going to be collected. Therefore, sampling is the process of collecting a sample from the population from which data is to be collected for deriving meaningful interpretation. So for accepting any sampling procedure, it is necessary to have a list or map identifying each sampling unit by a number. Such a list or map is called a sampling frame. For example, a list of students of a class, a list of patients of a particular disease, a list of workers in a factory, a list of voters, a list of staff members of a college, a list of villages in a district, etc. are few examples of a sampling frame. In brief, one should very well keep in mind that the statistical population is not only the human population, which is usually considered in literary sense, it is generally a group or collection of items specified by certain characteristics or defined under certain restrictions. So in this case, you can see that the sample size should always be around 20 to 30% of the study population. So after collection of the data, so the statistical analysis can be performed and which can give certain meaningful interpretations about the entire population. So in this slide, you can see the different types of data collection methods, and you can see that there are two major sources of the data collection. One is the primary source and the second one is the secondary source. So the data collection methods are generally classified into your primary and secondary. So this primary source can again be divided into your observation methods, interview methods, and questionnaire methods. So this observation methods can be either based on participant and non-participants, whereas the interview can be structured or unstructured, and the questionnaire methods can be basically done by personal, mail, or telephonic questionnaires. So in case of the primary collection of your data, this interview and questionnaire method are basically adopted, and these two are most of the times combined, which we will be discussing in the later slides. And the secondary source of the data are basically the documents which are sourced from the government publications, research reports, census, personal records, and service records, or any other sort of records. So we will one by one try to discuss about the different types of methods. So the major types of methods, so which includes the observation method. So in the observation method, the person who collects the data asks no questions. So in this case, no questions are asked, but they observe carefully the phenomenon under consideration and record the essential data. Observation can be done by an individual or by using some mechanical device or electronic device also. Whereas the major disadvantages of this method is the matter of accuracy. That is, it is very difficult to produce an accurate data through this method. The other demerit is the physical difficulties on the part of the observer. It may cause inaccurate data also. So due to these difficulties, this method is not followed as such, and therefore the questionnaire method is widely used for collecting the required data. In the questionnaire method, the researcher designs a questionnaire that contains all the relevant questions needed for the study. In this case, the investigator gets the required answer from the respondents and accordingly record it. This method of collecting data can be conducted through personal interview or by mail interview or by telephonic interview. In case of the personal interview method, the interviewer sits face to face along with the respondent and records their responses. The merits of this method are its accuracy and reliability. This is because the interviewer can clear up doubts and cross-check the respondents at the spot. The demerits of this method, on the other hand, are its processing time and cost. The cost and the time increases proportionately with the number of respondents. In the mail interview or the mail questionnaire method, the questionnaire is mailed to the respondent's residential or official address. The respondents are requested through a covering letter to fill it carefully and return it back to the investigator. Nowadays, the questionnaire can also be mailed through the electronic method. This method is advisable only if the respondents are spread over a wide geographical area and the respondents are literate. And it is applicable only when the personal interview is not possible. Accuracy and reliability are questionable because if any question or questions are not possible to understand by the respondents, they can give any answer as they like. So there is no guarantee for 100% returning of the filled questionnaire also. Therefore, the respondent should at least send to at least 3 times more the individuals from whom the investigator anticipates the responses. Similarly, in the telephonic interview method, the researcher asks relevant questions to the respondents over the telephone. So it is a less expensive method compared to the personal interview method and the mail questionnaire method. So the data collected through this method is also somewhat accurate. The main problem with this method is the respondent should have a telephone facility and they should have an ample time to discuss over phone. And in this method, there should also be a restriction regarding the number of questions to be asked over the phone, because it is very difficult to ask many questions to the respondents through the telephonic method. So, if we compare the questionnaire method and the quantitative method, we can say that the questionnaire method is the most efficient method through which the data can be collected very fast. Though it may be having restriction on certain sensitive aspects such as income, age, or personal life details, which the respondent may not be willing to share with the researcher. In the questionnaire method, the units of measurement have to be carefully defined, which helps to obtain uniformity in data and enable comparisons and the drawing of valid inferences. Also, it is highly essential to decide the degree of accuracy to which the data is to be collected. Finally, the preparation of the questionnaire plays a vital role. It should contain all the necessary questions, but not a very big one. The question should be clear and easy to understand to the respondents. The questions must be arranged in a sequential order and capable of getting all the necessary and accurate data. In the order to decide the quality of the questionnaire, a sample study of the questionnaire may also be done, which is called a pilot study. Based on the study report, the questionnaire can be modified if necessary before going to the field for collecting the data. So now we will discuss about the survey design briefly. So what is a survey design? A survey design includes designing a questionnaire, pre-testing a questionnaire, and editing the primary data. The success of the data collection totally depends on how efficiently and imaginatively the questionnaire has been designed. Certainly, a defective questionnaire will never be able to collect the relevant data. Regarding the designing of the questionnaire, the following points need to be constructed carefully. So, in a questionnaire, we should consider the following aspects. Firstly, a letter of introduction. A letter of introduction should be attached along with each questionnaire. It should specify the purpose of the study and should give assurance for the respondents regarding the maintenance of confidentiality. It has to be designed in such a fashion that it should motivate the respondents for better response. It should give the sense of satisfaction to the respondent. Secondly, the number of questions should be fixed. There is a close relationship regarding the number of questions asked in the questionnaire and the satisfaction of the respondents. Hence, the number of questions should be limited to a few only. It helps the respondent to give the accurate answers. Too many questions may lead to stress and strain to the respondent. The research study states that the number of questions in the questionnaire should be between 20 and 50. If it is more than 20, efforts should be there to try to put all the questions under proper subheadings in order to give clarity. Third, structure of the questions. It should be such that the question should be simple, short, and easy to understand. It can be yes or no type or multiple choice type of questions. Fourth, nature of the questions. It should not be sensitive. Moreover, it should not be related with the personal or confidential information. If such confidential information is required, then the word of confidence should be given to the respondents that it would not be disclosed to anyone at any point of time. The questions are to be designed in such a way that the answers does not require any kind of calculations. Fifth, the sequence of the questions. This needs to be considered with utmost importance. The question should be arranged in a proper sequence in such a way that there is a continuity of responses and it is not necessary for the respondents to refer back to the previous questions. It should be a mixture of introductory questions, crucial questions, and light questions. Then only the respondents gets the utmost satisfaction in answering the question. Sixth, there should be questions of cross-verification type. The questionnaire should contain some questions that are going to help to sense the reliability of the information provided by the respondents. Seventh, the questionnaire should be unique. Each question must be tested for its uniqueness. That is, the question must be designed to give the same meaning to each respondent. If it is left ambiguous, then the respondents may give different answers for the same meaning. Certainly, it will cause misleading assumption of the questions. Lastly, the responses to the questionnaire should lead to clarity. Therefore, the clarity of the questions must be tested carefully. If any change is needed, it should be carried over properly. If any question needs extra clarity for answering, some sort of clarification can be given by means of an example towards the end. For this, the researcher can use footnotes in occasion. So, after the questionnaire is properly designed, it must be pre-tested. So, pre-testing the questionnaire becomes very important before it is used for the survey work. So, this process is referred to as pilot survey that we have already discussed briefly few slides back. Clearly, this process precedes the actual survey work. Pre-testing the questionnaire permits the researcher to rectify the problem inconsistencies, repetitions, etc. The outcome of the pre-testing may need modifications over the existing questionnaire. So these modifications must be carried on over immediately before getting into the actual data collection from the respondents. So that is why pre-testing the questionnaire becomes very, very important before the survey work. Next, after the collection of the data is complete, that means after the end of the data collection process, the collected data must be edited before data analysis. So therefore, editing the primary data becomes important. So the primary data must be verified to ensure three aspects. One is the completeness, consistency, and the accuracy of the data collected. So each questionnaire should be verified that whether or not the respondents have answered for all the questions completely. So if any questions are found unanswered, so it should be tried to contact the respondent to get the answer. So if it is not possible to get the answer from the respondent again, so it should be dropped. That means that particular respondent should be dropped and all the other questionnaires should be used for analysis. So next is the consistency. That means in every case, the questionnaire should be carefully verified whether or not there are any contradictions or not. If any contradiction is there, then again, you should try to contact the respondent and clarify the answer. If any modification is there, so you should modify the answers. If it is not possible to sort out the contradictions, so then again, that particular questionnaire of the respondent should be dropped from the final list. Next, the final and the most important thing is the accuracy of the primary data collected. So the collected data must be verified for its accuracy. Even though it is not an easy job for the researcher, it has to be carried out carefully. If the inaccurate data is included by any means, certainly the outcome will not be accurate. For this reason, the researcher can use the random verification of the collected data. So after the primary data is edited, the respondent can attain some meaningful interpretations from the data. Now, let us consider some important aspects of the secondary data. Normally, there is more chance for the secondary data to contain error when compared to the primary data. Hence, the user of the secondary data should be very careful in employing the same. There can be different type of errors in the secondary data, including the transcribing error, estimating error, and the errors due to personal bias. Because of these errors, the secondary data users should be very careful about the following points and should decide how far the secondary data set is useful for the study under consideration. So this includes the complete history about the data, the methods used for the collection of the data, the time frame and the area covered, the source of reliability and the authenticity of the primary investigator, and the unitization of the measurements of the data collected. So the secondary data must be verified before using it. The user should not accept the secondary data as it is based on its face value. So this may be due to the personal biasness, size of the sample which may be less, computational errors, etc. Hence, the user of the secondary data should take extra care while using the secondary data. So we have come to the end of this video lecture. So in conclusion, I would like to emphasize that data is what makes the world go around, and there are many types of data collection methods which you can use to gain insights into your subject of interest. The one you choose will depend heavily on your goals, your customer base, your requirements, and the resources available to your organization. So, don't look at any methods as being better than the other. Rather, look at them as being appropriate for specific situations. So, therefore, start your data collection journey by choosing the collection method that's the easiest for you to implement right now, and work your way up as you start to see results from it. So, thank you. So I would like to ask for any queries. So if you have any queries regarding this video lecture, so you can mail all the queries and questions to the email ID provided here. So thank you.